Today on the next exciting episode of Donkey Kong for the Game Boy, I'm going to try to go an entire episode without saying the specific word I've been repeating over and over in every other Donkey Kong episode and even some Runaway Guys episodes. That's right, I'm going to try to go a whole episode without saying the word the. Except I'm pretty sure I just said it like twice, so let's forget about that then altogether. And let's move on to this world, the airplane levels, where I'm actually not really a big fan of these. It's the next two worlds, the worlds I'll be covered in this video, probably the most challenging, although the next stages are difficult in the standard platforming sense. These have specific mechanics which just make them more irritating than usual. If you haven't figured out the one for airplane already, it's the fact that it starts blowing you backwards and you just have to keep fighting against the current. And then again, we're on the outside of a plane. You can see the cockpit right there, so at least that makes sense. Well, okay. As far as sense goes from, like, running around outside of an airplane, which has switches on the outside of it and stomping, I guess you could say those are thwomps. It's giant crushers and everything. It's a little impractical, but whatever. We'll deal with it. And the world after that's actually the world I hate the most, Iceberg. And it's not because the stage is actually that hard. They're actually not that difficult. They're okay in difficulty, but my issues with the slipping mechanics. I hate ice physics in games. Now, I understand why they're still in games in general. They're just this kind of concept that you have to relearn how to play the game, essentially. They give you more mechanics you have to worry about in general, but I'm just not a fan of that whole concept. I like just tight controls, staying tight controls. Just put in more obstacles to make the game challenging instead of trying to just force people to relearn your game. I feel like I complain about ice physics a lot. I did it a lot in Ninja Gaiden, but But my main gripe with it is this. Like, take a game that has really good tight controls. Let's use Super Meat Boy as a good example. Like, those controls make or break Super Meat Boy for you. If you figure them out, they're great. If you can't figure them out, you might think it's the worst game ever. Now imagine if you took those controls and made them super slippery. Like, even worse than usual. I don't remember any ice levels in Super Meat Boy. If I'm wrong about this, I am so sorry because this completely destroys my point. But as far as I remember, there's nothing besides maybe like some slippery sections. There's no fully blown ice level which completely ruins the experience for you. It's all about the tight controls and the challenge you can build from that. To me, get back here! To me, ice physics, or why I just got shot in the balls. To me, ice physics are just artificial challenge. They're not actually like, they're a crutch of gameplay design. That's my opinion. It's just my opinion. If you think that they add more to, I didn't realize you could do that! I've never seen him do that fast, crap. Damn it, Donkey Kong, stop doing that. I just think, I don't know, like I said, it's my opinion. If you don't agree with my opinion, that's quite alright. I can fully understand, but there's always a gameplay mechanic in a game or that recurs in a series of games that people hate, like sewer levels. For the longest time, people were always complaining about sewer levels. To me, ice stages are my sewer levels. That sounds really weird. When I verbalize it, it sounds even stranger than it was in my head. So we're getting introduced to the new turret mechanic, which really just means slower moving bullets that you see coming. I believe they also only appear in this world, so get ready for that lovely challenge. But thankfully, Airplane's actually one of the shortest worlds next to the beginning, so it ties up with Big City in length. And the second half isn't that bad, actually. I can usually jam through this pretty fast. Case in point right here. I'm about to get shot. I don't want to press the button, because I know I'm about to get shot. Yeah, I should have turned to the left. See, this is what happens when you take a break between recording sessions. You fall apart. It's just the worst. Okay, so what you're supposed to do, you can just jump up for that normally if you do a backflip, but it's easier just to use a trampoline, go up, avoid getting shot, and this becomes the easy part. The door's way back where you started, so you just have to walk down. You can take one hit from the cannons because you have the key in your hand, so really just a case of being careful. Which admittedly, I have not been a fan of if you've been watching any of these videos. Okay, so now apparently, oh, we actually are in a cloud, look at that. And we're gonna regain our 99 lives again. I wish 99 lives did something in this game. In later Mario games in general, 99 lives or crown lives, depending on what game you're playing, did something. It made you take off your hat. It was a nice little touch. Like spikes, a nice touch like spikes. I'm falling apart this episode, holy cow. It was a nice little touch, and it made it actually feel like you did something by getting all those lives. And heck, even in New Super Mario Bros. 2, I believe the fifth star out of your star rankings is getting crown lives. At least that's when I got my fifth one, so I don't know if anyone else found that to be different. I haven't looked at a listing online. But I don't know. I guess back at this point, too, we got to keep in mind that the first time they started doing that was, I believe that was New Super Mario Bros.? Or was that the Wii version that they actually started doing that? Either way, that was a mechanic they added way later on, so expecting it in like a almost 20-year-old game is a little hypocritical. But I don't know. I like little touches like that where it's like, oh, you've maxed out your lives. You're clearly good at this game, or you've clearly gotten really good at the minigames for lives, so have this nice little extra thing. It'd be like, you know, maybe change that background at the beginning of the game or something like that. None of those changes happen in this game, so. But I just think that'd be a nice touch for like hardcore enthusiasts to aim for, and I'm glad that Nintendo does that with their games now. I just wish it wasn't so easy to max out your lives in like Nintendo's current games now, because it kind of is. I mean, look at New Super Mario Bros. 2. Ignoring the fact that the mechanic of the game, the whole coin collecting thing, kind of brought that on itself. Lives are everywhere in that game. It also, well. See, I hate it when I have a point and then I realize, oh no, there's reasons for some of these points. Because, I was going to say, because all the extra lives they add everywhere, you can catch them all at Coin Rush for coin bonuses as well. So really, that still also plays towards the end game of get all the coins you can. But is that enough of a reason too, is the thing.
Deep philosophical game discussion while playing Donkey Kong.
I don't know, I'm just kind of musing, I'm waxing, I'd say waxing lyrical, or not really singing it. How would you sing about your opinion about video games? No, I'm not even gonna try, I'm sorry. I will spare you my attempt to be that rapping white boy, because I'm sure there's enough rapping white boys out there as it is. The world does not need any more. Although I will miss Beastie Boys. I am such a white. I'm such a middle-class white boy. That's why I made so much fun of it last episode. So we've discovered through this LP so far that I am a middle-class white boy who really is way too cocky about his own abilities sometimes, and is a very large man-child. So really, this LP is bringing the best out of me. I feel like I'm going to have to start drinking after this LP. Alright, let's get off this airplane and land on an iceberg. I don't know how that works, but you clearly just saw us walk off an off-ramp. I just want to say this right now. Listen to the music here for a second. Least favorite theme out of all the stages. It's just so melancholy. It sounds so, like, tense, too. And then they just put in this awesome song. This is probably my favorite song, one of my favorites at least, like, cuz there's so many good songs in this game. You know, it sounds like I'm going to try to solve like a mystery, like, I don't, well, a mystery. The mystery of why this giant monkey keeps kidnapping my girlfriend. You got to wonder, what is Mario thinking that his girlfriend keeps getting kidnapped all the time by this giant gorilla? Like, why does this keep happening to him? This clearly isn't the first time this happened, either. Oh, sweet, that trick worked. Okay, so normally this gate would close completely. You'd have to use the switch to open up, drop the key, then run down there through the ladder. But because there was an ice block still there while the flames were melting them,
It actually froze the platform in place, which just let me walk down.
Very convenient.
And here I was complaining at the beginning of the episode I wouldn't be able to use any of the shortcuts. Or, I should say, that's actually why I'm not a big fan of these stages, because the shortcuts are a lot harder to pull off. I guess they're not even that big of a reward, too, which is the worst part. Like, some of the airplane ones are really good. I skipped one on 6-2 where you have to flip off the giant crusher that's there. That lets you pull off a really nice shortcut. But it's just a huge pain in the ass to pull off. Meanwhile, last time I was playing this stage, I totally botched it. And I guess I should introduce you to our new enemy, the giant psychotic walrus. He'll lunge at you with his teeth if he sees you, which is just great. And we also have to deal with icebergs, or ice chunks, I guess. Ice floats? I think ice floats work. If you stay on them too long, they just start dipping down, so you have to keep jumping in place, or attempting to jump in place, before you kill yourself. If you go into the water and the key's in your hand, you sink. You cannot swim with the key in your hand. So you have to drop it, go all the way back up, and attempt to do it all over again. And this stage introduces another fun little mechanic. Invisible doors. Notice how the exit is not visible. You actually have to remember where it is. I think it only comes into play in the iceberg stages. But that's all it really needs to happen. It's tricky. I think I can just do this without... If I time this right, I did it. Yeah. Nope, I'm closing the door. Not enough time on the clock. Alright, so the iceberg stages are a little bit more platforming oriented when it comes to Donkey Kong's challenges. And we haven't even gotten to the main difference between these ice stages and other ice stages. That'll come up momentarily when we get to the next set. Alright, you need to crush. Noise! Blech. What? Ah, damn it, I thought I got away from it.
I mean, you used to be good at games, and then you just started sucking for some reason. I don't know why the hell that happened.
There we go. You would pull that now! I remember when I said at the beginning of this recording that these stages aren't that hard. Then I started dying like crazy. You know that word I've been saying a lot in other episodes? I really wish I could say it right now. God damn it. Just show me the next cutscene. Alright, this is the mechanic that actually adds to the stage and adds a bit of a challenge. You now have icicles that'll fall down and impale you if they hit you, but you have to use them as platforms, so you have to kind of lure them all out. It's kind of tricky. But then again, ice stage. And really, it's a better mechanic than just, like, making even slipperier ice or, like, making you die instantly if you touch water. And as much as I've been talking about ice physics, this stage doesn't really suffer it too bad. So this is a case where, you know, tight controls still kind of went out and there's still challenge in general. That's always good. Well, and the killer walruses. You gotta worry about the killer walruses all the time. But I love how, like, regal and important they look, and then suddenly they're like, ah! There we go. Let's grab the key, and let's just ride this dropping platform down. And that's the end for that stage. Now, there's one tricky puzzle stage in Iceberg. I didn't even realize I did that again. Fairly similar to the one in Desert, if you guys remember the one where you had to put up all the platforms and all the springboards and everything. This one, I think, is actually easier in some ways. But in a way, you still kind of need to know the whole setup, because it has an invisible door and everything. Really, the main issue you'll have to worry about in the iceberg stages here is this, the ice you have to melt, and not getting burned by giant fireballs. Apparently a major concern of Mario. First Bowser, now Donkey Kong. Okay. All I need is just enough to get up there with the key. So let's just ride this up.
You do need more fire to be there, though. You need... There's more ice to melt here. So, let's... You're going to be there first. So, let's put a platform here. So, these guys will melt the ice, which works out perfectly. We got to put a platform under the door. And now we just got a couple seconds to see if we can get up there before I screw everything up. Come on, come on, come on, I need the key! A little too close. Let's just make sure the fire doesn't get in there. Good job, Mario. Good job. Okay, so if you did not already know about the unable to swim with key in your hand mechanic, this stage actually forces you to use it. Because you have to get over here, and notice how there's a giant fish, and these two... Oh, wait, what?
Oh, I threw the key first!
Stupid! Okay, so I was trying to be clever, and it screwed up. Welcome to the recurring theme of this LP. I was trying to get this guy to kill me, or to hit me, so I would drop the key on everyone else, like that. Well, it only got him, but... What happened was I hit the throw button at the exact same instant he hit me. Which means I died. Horribly. There we go. Now, I can't take the key with me. It actually has to go back up to the start. It's the only way to actually solve this stage. Because you have to set the platform here to get to the door. And then run for it. Fortunately, there's all these little... extra platforms you can set up to reset the clock for the platforms, but you've got to also dodge this guy right here! Thankfully, it is not that difficult. Notice how I'm being awkwardly quiet after that. I'm like, shoot, I shouldn't have gotten away with that one. Also, wow, I didn't realize how much time that stage gave you. It could be 300 seconds? That's ridiculous. I think that's the most time you get for any stage in this game. All right, now, thankfully, these conveyor belts all go the same specific direction you need to go, so you don't need to sweat too much about it. If you know the wall jumping trick, which, once again, I have not been able to show off, it does make the stage crazy fast. You just go to the right side of the wall, flip up, you're on that platform just to the right, and just jump up super fast. I don't know if any of you guys who are watching this like to go on high score websites or anything like that. I'm a big fan of a website called CyberScore, which is based in the UK. They do all these time trials for games and everything. I know the name of the site kind of gives you different ideas, but it is a video game scoring website. God, that just made it sound even worse. So CyberScoring. I looked at a lot of the times for Donkey Kong and the Game Boy on there. I think it's just called Donkey Kong and then brackets GB. Some of the times for stages are absolutely ridiculous. Like the very first stage, the one that I showed you, you could do in 3 seconds. The fastest time is 2 seconds. Some other stages, which has taken me about 30 seconds plus to beat, takes about 5. And it's mostly because of wall jumping. But some people just have figured out crazy ways to flip through stages. It's absolutely mind-boggling. And some of the links actually have video there, so if you can watch footage of that stuff, by all means, watch it. It's great viewing. On this cyber scoring website. Oh, that's an unfortunate name choice. So we had to pull that switch earlier because the elevator would be going straight down otherwise, hence why the little piece of ice is there for us to use as a platform, which I somehow didn't end up using. Because I somehow glitched the elevator, did not get stun lock, and made it down by falling. You're actually supposed to ride the piece of ice down. Why do I keep accidentally picking up the ice? For those of you who are wondering, like, came into the episodes late, I'm not picking up the items because A, my life counter's been maxed out for the majority of the game, and any lives I lose, I regain when I fight Donkey Kong. And because it's just kind of going out of the way. You don't really need to do it at all. If you're going for a high score, sure, it's great. Or if you really need the extra lives! Ice physics! Alright, I can just do this. I don't think I can do it for this one, though. Can? No. No point challenging it when there's the ice piece right here. So I need this ice piece to land here so I can use the ladder, because it's not touching the ground. And I need to actually get this one while it's in midair. Which I missed. I'm just gonna
duck my head here in shame and wait for it to come back. See, this is a mechanic I don't think ever really came back for other Mario games, just like riding platforms like that, or... No, well, that's not entirely true now, is it? Dropping icicles have actually been in later Mario games. Heck, it's in New Super Mario Bros. Wii, and I think even the 2 as well. Every ice world seems to have that, but... Okay, here we go, this is the actual puzzle stage. You absolutely have to remember where that door is, because otherwise... When you pick up the item, you can't see anything. Even if you flip the color schemes, which the Game Boy Color, or the Super Game Boy lets you do that, you can't see the outlines. You have to remember where it is, otherwise, you're gonna be here for a while. Uh-oh. Oh, right, I just have to wait, never mind. Okay, for a second I'm like, shoot, did I just get trapped? I am so dead unless I can get the springboard. Let's go for it. Go for it! Yeah, there we go.
And then I just
stood there like an idiot and died. Alright, so the way to actually solve this stage, let's see how I can do this. The door is approximately here. That's why it actually won't let me put a platform there to warn you you're actually trying to put it on the door. So you go two down, and we've got that there. So now how are we gonna get up there? The springboard, obviously. But I put it too high! So now I have to use this little tiny platform, jump up there. Now you can actually, I believe you can place the springboard in a position where you don't even need the small block. If you put it down one lower, you can clear the jump, but I don't know if you can spring up that high. But it's just easier to do it that way, the stepping stone. So now we have to get barrels while dodging deadly icicles. Which usually both land in the same spot, making barrel grabbing very irritating. And I just died. Not on my A game. I think, is that the first death I've had to Donkey Kong? Besides the one I staged? Gonna do it twice! This is the heavily edited episode of Donkey Kong for the Game Boy. This is what happens when you end up trying to play a game while you're not feeling well. You don't want to know how many times I've tried to record this one specific episode. Because everyone in my house has been sick since PAX, and I've been feeling sick, but it hasn't actually affected my throat yet, which it usually does. So, the majority of the time I've been trying to do this, I've either just kind of trailed off, or I've just gotten, like, started coughing like crazy and just had to stop. So, as you can see, we've finally gotten off the iceberg, and if you look in the distance, you can see a small tower there? That's actually where the game ends. Some people pointed out in the comments, and I missed this, I didn't comment on it. You can see that tower in earlier stages as well, you can see it way off in the distance. So I just love it when they put in like nice little touches like that. Apparently, I think you can see it in the jungle, is what people were telling me. But go back to other episodes and see if you can spot the tower yourself. You'll be surprised that you can. And as we say goodbye to the iceberg, we get to the Rocky Valley. And this is the largest world, I believe, in the game. Or second largest, because I think jungle was the exact same length. And that also means next episode, we're done the game. Because we're going to be doing Rocky Valley and then the tower. So I'll see you guys then.